Eyres on the Road, value-based parenting and life balance ideas from world-traveling family coaches. Here's Richard and Linda Eyre.
Well, hello, wherever you are, and welcome to Eyres on the Road.
It's February. Can you believe it's February?
I can't believe it's February. Wow.
It's almost one of our son's birthday, the one that lives in Switzerland. We got to start thinking
almost
about that. Well,
yeah.
A couple of days.
Only 11 birthdays in January, so we're going to get started now on
February.
We have
more birthdays, grandkids, they all got born in January.
No, there's a lot through the year. But anyway, it is always a good time, and February in Maui is just a good place to be. Although,
did we have some torrential rain. My goodness. Our little house here has a tin roof, and when it rains hard, it's kind of like being inside a tent, only more metallic and vibrant.
Oh, my goodness. We have never seen rain like this. Flood watches everywhere. 5 days, never let up. It was amazing. But now it's so green and beautiful. It is amazing.
Back to the beauty. So, and we, we've got another week or a little over a week, got another 10 days here, and then we'll be back home. And we're trying to finish up a few of these writing projects that we really came here to do. Just so you know, we did not come here just to play around.
We just don't play around. At least I don't just play around.
Wait a minute. You have been working really hard. Linda's been, we're working, one of the things we're working on is our family history. And boy, you're good at that, honey. You have a better memory than I do. And you have a way of writing stories and anecdotes that are just,
Oh, no.
Fun to read.
Thank you. But it's just a matter of getting it down on paper. Man, it is just so fun to think back through a lot of things, though, and things that you've totally forgotten. And then sometimes I read things that I just wrote last week and I'd forgotten. So you never know.
Well, I got a call just the other day, 2-3 days ago, and it was Linda who was out on a run. And she said, come quick. There's a little tiny, tiny baby fawn. And I don't know how to get him out. And I said, get him out of what? And she said, well, he's down in a culvert. He's lost. His mom is not here. What are we going to do? She, I think you didn't say he. We just assume
we
it was a little
she,
girl.
Of course.
But tell about that. That was a serendipity. If that was a serendipitous morning.
Well, it was just amazing. For some reason, I decided to go up a different path. I'm out jogging and walking. And I just went a little different direction. I just went around the corner. It's not very far from our house. And I heard this little yipping, like a little cat or a little dog in distress.
Kind of crying.
Crying.
Yeah.
And like, help. And I
bet it didn't really say help.
Anyway, so I thought, I wonder what that is. And I walked across the street and I looked down in this little culvert, and there was the cutest little baby fawn. It couldn't be more than a day or two old.
A little spotted baby deer, a little fawn. Just, I bet it was.
Oh, maybe 14.
A foot high, a little more.
Yeah. With long, spindly legs, kind of shaking and looking up at me through there, like, what are you going to do? Oh, gosh. And it was so adorable. And I just thought, what in the world? How can I get this little sweetheart to safety? I don't know what to do. So I called Richard.
By the time I ran up there, a woman had stopped.
Well, let me just say, the first car that came along while I was there, she rolled down her window and said, is there a problem? And I said, look at this. And by then it had walked back. I talked it into walking back through the culvert on the other side. But
still
it was
down
a big,
in the ditch.
That
couldn't get out of.
There's no way it could get out. And she jumped out of the car and we talked about it for a little while and just kept looking at us and being kind of scared if we got too close. And finally she just said, okay, I am going to get down in there and get that little thing. And she was really, she was amazing. So she got down in there and grabbed that little thing, which immediately pooed all over her.
and started to struggle and cry.
Struggling and
but crying. We got a towel and put over her little face, and she calmed right down. And Katie is the name of this gal, and she was holding that little thing like a baby.
Okay, so this is the serendipity thing. She knew exactly what to do. She lived here for 13 years. She said, I know a place that takes stray animals. And it's just, she said, down the road. It was quite a way down the road.
And it's called the Boo Boo Zoo.
Called the Boo Boo Zoo. And so it was absolutely.
It's not really a zoo, by the way.
An amazing experience. And no, it's not really a zoo. It was the wildest place. I mean, we went, I drove and she held that little baby girl. And we just went through, you know, all kinds of curves and all this stuff and beautiful, beautiful scenery. And then we come to this little old beat up sign that says Boo Boo Zoo with an arrow. To make a long story short, gosh, there were gates to go through. But when we got there, it was like, oh my gosh, it's like a combination of Dr. Seuss, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, and a homemade zoo that you just cannot believe. There were animals everywhere, just mostly outside were chickens and geese and goslings and peacocks and all kinds of bird, you know, feathered birds that were standing.
Bird or
and there were old beat up cars hanging around, and the birds were on top of the cars. Anyway, that we couldn't find a man. We finally found this guy who helped us so kindly, and he led us over to a little pen that was in the back. Lots of pens. And we just put that sweet little thing down in this little pen along with another baby.
Not even a pen, more of a room inside this.
Well, it
big
had carpet
structure.
In it.
Yeah,
carpet.
It was a night. And there were other little baby. I wasn't there, but I saw the pictures.
It had a little,
other little small
a baby deer, a little goat about her same size.
Anyway,
they smelled each other up and they were happy. So that was the end of it.
The bottom line of the serendipity is we met Katie later that night for dinner, and she brought her partner, Mike, and we got some new friends, and they're just really special.
They
people.
Are really special people. They married. Well, they were just partners for 13 years.
We're going to talk them into getting married.
And had a beautiful business of coconuts. They do custom coconuts for weddings. I mean, you know, what in the world? How did that happen? It was amazing.
Anyway, sorry for that little, but I was my fault. I was just thinking that was a fun story to tell. But what are we going to talk about today? We have been meeting on the phone, on Marco Polo, on Zoom, on FaceTime with a granddaughter who's making a very, very, very big decision, the biggest she can make, I guess. And we have been trying to help her and counsel with her a little bit. And we've been talking a lot, thinking a lot about decisions, big decisions, choices, particularly the ones that our children and grandchildren make as they become teenagers and as they move into college or into their lives. And we all know, I mean, it goes without saying that some of these choices that are made in the early part of life, we call it the second seventh. If you divide your life into sevenths, they're all about 11 years long, 11 or 12 years long, each of those sevenths. And that second seventh, between the time a person's around 12 and around 24 or 25, think of the decisions they're making, what to major in, where to go, where to live, what to study, what kind of career to pursue, who to marry, whether to have a child, life-changing decisions. And our feeling is that a lot of times kids kind of fall into decisions. They just sort of go with the flow, and what comes along is what they do. And we don't think it's that's the way it should be. So we've spent a lot of time with our children and with our grandchildren talking about the art of making good decisions, making spiritual decisions, if you will, making decisions that are consistent with things we can't even know, but that God knows. And wow, it's just been so interesting to talk to this wonderful granddaughter, and we're still in the process of talking to her. And it takes us back to, you know, there's a we have this little set of principles that we call grandfather's secrets or grandparents' secrets. I sometimes say grandfathers because you've got this Grammy camp that's so wonderful, and you know, part of my motivation for creating these grandfather's secrets was I didn't want to be such a slug when you were
doing this,
you know, Grammy camp and all this, but they're just sort of 10 principles to live by. And one of them is the Holy Spirit will help you with all your decisions, large and small, semicolon, and many of the large ones can be made in advance. So let me explain that a little and you break in, honey. What we're trying to say is that, you know, there's really sort of three kinds of decisions, if you think about it, that kids make. One is just the little decisions that just come along all the time. Like, do I be nice to this person? Do I try to stop this other kid from bullying this kid? Am I polite? Am I courteous? Am I honest? I mean,
should I do my homework? No. I mean, whether or not you do what you know you should do, you know.
Yeah, so there's little everyday decisions. But then there's these really big ones, and they can be sort of, the reason I said three, there's sort of two kinds. There's the kind you can actually make in advance. Mention what I mean by that. And then there's the kind that you can't make in advance because you don't know what the options will be. So an example of the first one would be, you know, you can decide in advance not to do drugs. You can decide in advance that you're going to go to college if that's your goal or whatever. You can decide in advance that you're going to be honest on in your test taking and so on. I mean, you can... There's a list of decisions that are actually best made in advance, because if you leave them until the moment of choice, the temptation is greater. You know, if you've decided you're not going to do drugs, but you haven't really made the decision, and then you have to make that decision when you're at this party and there's a lot of peer pressure and the girl you like best is saying, just try this little pill or whatever.
Yeah. In fact, we have really encouraged our kids when they were about 10 or 11, we would give them a book that was like a diary engraved with their name on the front and said, this is to just record some special experiences that you have in your life, but turn to the last page first and put at the top of the page this title, Decisions I Have Made in Advance. And then we want you to think about what can you decide right now? What can you decide right now? And it has been such a good process to go through.
So like, even though you're only 12 or 13 or whatever, what decisions can you make already? And then instead of pushing them, we almost play devil's advocate and say, it's like, say one of them says, well, I'll never do drugs. Well, we try to put them in a scenario 4 years from now or 5 years from now. You're at this party. This happens. What do you say? What do you do? How are you sure in your own mind you've really made that decision in advance?
So it has been a huge tool. I mean, they came up with 6 or 8 things, and then we had them sign them, seal them, slit their thumb open, sign in blood. No, just kidding. But I mean, they thought about it before, and it really was helpful in their lives. They have expressed some appreciation for that as they've gone through, because they said, if I hadn't thought about that beforehand, I would have made a really bad choice on this in this case.
And so now we're trying to do that with our grandkids, with the consent of their parents and the teamwork with their parents. What decisions can you make in advance? But then there's the other decisions, you know, that you can't make in advance, like what do you study? Where do you live? Who do you marry? And those are the ones that we feel should be made in a very interesting formula, a very interesting process. And we're going to talk a little about that after the break and see if we can be a little helpful in prompting some thought on your part as a parent or a grandparent on what these three kinds of decisions are and how you can help a young person figure out which of the three types of decision it is and how to best make each of those choices, which will change their impact their entire life.
So hang on. We'll be right back with some ideas for you.
Welcome back to Eyres on the Road. Here's Richard and Linda Eyre.
And we're back.
Talking about decisions and choices. We all have them. We you know, even old fogies like us, Linda, have to make decisions. Like today, we have to decide if we go to the beach or to the mountains.
Or work.
Linda always says work before play, and I tend to say, oh, that's another subject.
Yeah, that
we'll
is
get into
totally,
that.
Yeah.
We'll get into that later. But anyway, back to decisions. So again, quick review, and then we'll try to just delve into these a little. Three kinds of decisions. One, the kind of person you're going to be, that, you know, the little things day to day, the little things that you just decide you're going to do certain things and be honest and be true and be friendly and not do things that you don't want to do. The little daily decisions. And you can think through those better than we can, or as well as we can. But then in the larger ones, first, the kind that you really can make in advance. And you did a good job explaining that, Linda, that, you know, each of our children as they were growing up, and now many of our grandchildren have a diary or a journal. And in the end of it somewhere is this wonderful page, decisions I have made in advance, things I can decide now, even though I haven't come to that fork in the road or that crisis. And let's just go through what's, you know, and we try not to push or encourage certain ones, but examples. Talked about not doing drugs. I will not smoke. I will not drink.
I will go to college. I am going to go to college. I mean, obviously there's things that can come up that can
and it's not,
get you off track
for everyone. Yeah,
but it may not be for them, but what they want to do. And it is so powerful when you have made a decision. I don't know. I love a book about habits. That'll come to me in a second. But it is Atomic Habits. Yeah. I mean, if you make up your mind you're going to do certain things, it is amazing what happens. Well, even things that are impossible in some cases.
And it leads to such great discussions, because when a parent or a grandparent is sitting with a 12 or 13 or 14 year old, what are some decisions you can make right now? And you start thinking, where will you be in 5 years? What will you be doing? What will be some of the things that are on your mind? What are the things you're going to have to decide? You know, so most of them made the decision, I will be married at some point. I will have children. Now you may say, well, you can't always control these things. But having a decision made as far as how you feel about something and what you plan to do or not do, it's not a guarantee, but it is a powerful deterrent to some of the temptations that kids will feel as they grow up and as they start going out on their own and so on. But the third kind, the last kind of decision, which is the one we've been trying to help this granddaughter with lately, you know, it's a decision where you now are trying to decide something you know will change your life. Should you marry this person? Should you get into this program in school? Should you accept this job? Should you make this move to another location? These kinds of things that come along and that we don't want to fall into. We want to make them the right way. And we feel that that is where the most spiritual kind of decision comes in. And we know that all of you who listen to Eyres on the Road are not members of the same church and don't necessarily have the same beliefs spiritually. But we feel like most of us, the majority of this community, believes in a higher power that has a lot more knowledge and a lot greater scope of of awareness than we do. And so the question is, how do you tap in to that source and get that kind of guidance on these decisions? Because we do the best we can on decisions. We analyze the data we have. We try to figure out what we're doing. But we don't know enough. I mean, that's the sad thing. That's what I was saying to this granddaughter the other day. You really don't know enough. You think you know this person that you're trying to decide whether you want to marry, but you'll, in 10 years, look back and realize you hardly knew anything. So how in the world can you be expected to make a decision of that kind of magnitude? And the answer is, we think, in a scripture that we believe in, that essentially says, what you do is you bring to bear your all the advice, all the analysis, all the effort, all the prayer, all the feelings you can, and you make your own decisions, and you try to come to the right choice. But you make that decision tentatively, and then you essentially take that decision to God in prayer and attempt to get what we would call a confirmation, attempt to get an acquiescence, if you will, from God or from the Spirit, from the Holy Spirit, that confirms your decision, that says it is right. And the scripture we have in mind actually has some very interesting wording. It says, if it be right, if your decision, if the choice you have made, God won't make the choice for you, because the whole purpose of mortality is that we learn to make our own choices and find our own way and so on. So saying, please tell me what I should do, please tell me what decision I should make, God, is a very different thing and a less profitable thing, we feel, than saying, God, I have worked so hard, I have tried to bring to bear all the advice, the analysis, the feelings, the thoughts, hope you've given me. I've tried to bring all that to bear, and this is my decision, but I will not act on it until you confirm it. And this scripture we're talking about essentially says, if it is right, I will cause that your bosom shall burn within you, and you shall know that it is right. And we're careful with that burning, because some people feel this as a calmness or a sureness or a simple peace, and others feel it like a burning. But we really believe that when someone does the work and tries to make that decision and then asks God for a confirmation, we really believe one of two things will happen. They'll either receive that confirmation in some form of sureness, which is money in the bank. The rest of their life, they'll never second guess that decision. They'll never say, well, I really didn't know the person well enough to marry him, or, well, I really didn't know enough about the job, I shouldn't have accepted it, or whatever. With this spiritual confirmation, whatever difficulties come, you'll say, well, I know that this was the right thing to do. I got it. I felt it from the Spirit. So it's a beautiful thing. And the other option, if the confirmation doesn't come, the scripture calls it a stupor of thought, which I think is just the absence of that confirmation, which says you got some more thinking to do. You haven't thought this through well enough. There's factors you don't know about. Go back to the drawing board. Work on it harder. Come back again when your decision's more complete.
Well, I think that there are so many decisions that we make. I mean, some are a lot more important than others, obviously. But for us, and for me especially, I needed to have that very sure feeling before I married you, because I knew that you were kind of a loose cannon.
Wait a second.
No, I knew that it was not going to be totally easy, because we had spent most of our courtship arguing.
Wonderful arguments. Oh, yeah. So wonderful.
I mean, we really...
You almost won, but...
Well, no, just a little more than half the time. But it really was hard, because we realized we look at the world differently, and we see things the way they should be resolved differently. And I felt like I needed to absolutely know this is the right thing to do. And we've had people say, you know, I have struggled with that. I tried, but I just couldn't. And I don't know. I think they've been they've been okay, but it's just been a whole different thing for me. Like when we came to an impasse, like, okay, this, and I have to admit that there have been some
There have been times when if we hadn't had that confirmation, being a little personal here, I'm not sure we would have made it, especially early in our marriage.
Yeah. We have told you before how the bad advice that we got from the guy who married us about never going to sleep on an argument. Sometimes we were going all night long and exhausted, and it was just the absolute worst thing to do. We should have separated right at the first, given it a fresh look. And
not separated, but you know.
I mean, gone to different places, yeah.
No trial separation. So I think, you know, we're kind of on a personal scale and on an advice scale and different things here. But the bottom line, I think, Linda, is that we really believe in that particular wonderful kind of an answer to prayer. We believe in prayer. We believe in a God who cares about us individually and who knows vastly more everything that we don't know, and who will help us on these decisions, but not by taking the initiative from us, not by making the decision for us, not by, you know, doing the work that we should do, but rather by confirming the decision that we've made. And it's you know, it's just logical when you think about it. If you believe in a creator, if you believe in a God, if you believe in a higher intelligence that knows so much more, why would we not seek that kind of confirmation before we undertake the implementation of these life-changing decisions? There's thing, and again, so many of them come in that second seventh of life, in that period where we haven't had a lot of life experience, and yet we're trying to make decisions on marriage, on study, on where to live, on career, on so many things that are beyond our scope. So we do the best we can, we come to the best decision we can, and then we believe in fasting and prayer, becoming as humble as possible, taking that decision to some private, quiet, peaceful place, and simply asking for a confirmation of that decision. And we believe that's maybe the most valuable thing that young people can do.
It really is. And there are so many kind of big decisions in your life. I mean, the few that are really, really will be life-changing. But it really is amazing to think about that you do have help. And I know some have just struggled, like, I can't get an answer. And then finally, when they absolutely decide, this is what I'm going to do, they do get maybe not a wild burning, but a firm feeling, yes, this is the direction I should go. It is so ethereal that it's hard to pin down, because every person receives that a different way. But it is so important to rely on God, I think, for these big answers,
these big confirmations. And again, we're almost out of time, but I just want to be a little personal here at the end and say that it's certainly not our idea. A wonderful man, a mentor, a leader, a man I actually believe was an apostle during his life, is the one that explained that confirmation process to me years ago. And I did what he asked. I did fast. I did pray on the decision I'd made to marry you, honey. And I received, high on a mountain in some snow, kneeling down, I received a total calmness, a total peace. And I knew for sure ever since. And you had your own experience.
Yeah, mine happened in like 1 minute after a long process and so on. So it just comes differently to everyone, but it's a sweet experience.
So our appeal to you, especially you parents and grandparents, talk a lot with your children and grandchildren about decision-making and about the kinds of decisions they can make in advance, just as they think it through and decide what kind of person they want to be and how they want to live and what they will and won't do during their life. And then this bigger kind of, not bigger, but other kind of decisions where they do the work, make the choice prayerfully, carefully, but don't act on it until they get this sure confirmation from the Spirit of God. So let me just repeat that little secret or little principle we try to teach. The Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit will help you with all of your decisions, large and small, and many of them can be made in advance.
So thanks for joining us today. We just want you to know that if you find a little stranded fawn in a culvert, jump down in there and get it and take it somewhere safe. And it's kind of it's the same thing on the other end of the spectrum, but it is really great to jump into the things that you know are right and do it.
We love y'all. If you happen to be a grandparent, you should know that we're starting our Grandparenting 101 course again next month in March, and we'd love to have you join us. Or if you're a parent and you have your parents that you think would benefit from thinking about more proactive grandparenting, just go to grandparenting101.com, and we'd love to have you join us.
And it's February 9th this month, right?
No, February 7th. That's the last one of the previous course, so they would want to join. Probably.
Okay, so thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Eyres on the Road.
Love to all.